Welcome back. You're still watching Checkpoint. My name is Lynn Komjisha, and with me is Dr. Fiona Kalinda. We're trying to look at the role mango plays in addressing health challenges as a country. Yeah, it is addressing it as a kingdom, but also generally as a country. So we are looking at all that, and of course ahead of the World AIDS Day that falls on 1st December. We all know that December, then eventually, before we head into festivities, we are doing HIV/AIDS, really. We are focusing on the fight against HIV/AIDS because we need to end it by 2030. Dr. Fiona, before we went for a break, we have noticed that the Kabaka's subjects have challenges. What are these challenges, and in regard especially to HIV/AIDS?
Well, the challenges are not very different from what the rest of the country, you know, is facing. First of all, people would complain before that they would go sometimes for HIV testing. There's this issue of distance, which is why the health camps, when we did the health camps, would get so many people. And then distance, but the ministry has tried its best, the Ministry of Health, central government, to make sure that testing, you know, is now everywhere. And then, of course, the behavior change is one of the main major problem. We still have people having casual sex, you know. Research has shown that up to 50% of men in a population-based survey that was done here in central Uganda as well, you know, were saying that they slept with people who are not their permanent partners. We have children having an early sexual debut, 11-year-olds. That's a big challenge because we're having HIV, you know, coming in right through there. Then we have poor attitude to condoms. And then some people say the condoms don't fit them. There's a lot of things that...
Myths, you know, misconceptions.
Yeah, misconceptions about... And of course we do have other myths, you know, for example, among the fishermen, some of us who told us that the more women you sleep with, the more fish you catch. So meaning that we have to be talking about condom use and not abstinence or being faithful among that population. So we have stigma and discrimination. 40 years after this epidemic started, we still have people being discriminated because of their HIV status. And, you know, being stigmatized in the communities these days.
There's still a lot also on the costs and access to these services that are available. I think the interesting challenge that I think we are managing to help, but COVID has also had a huge impact, especially with access to services. What do you have to say about that?
We did have a problem, especially during the first lockdown. Even this second lockdown, when there was this inter-district thing, because there are some people who don't want to take HIV services from their home district, where the Basa will know them, stigma, you know. So they had to cross to different districts. And at first, you know, there was that restriction. So, but we thank, you know, the ministry which came in, because we made noise. So the ministry came in and they were allowed to move with their HIV cards. If you had your ARV card, you could move. But during the first lockdown, people, you know, because it caught us unawares, some people, you know, missed drugs because some people say someone is in Mitiana, had moved to Mitiana in the lockdown, found them there, and they had to come for their drug pickup, and, you know, there was no way to get there. But HIV/AIDS partners tried to get around there and got some communal transport, got some community points where they could give them, you know, like Infectious Disease Institute. So I think also HIV testing reduced during the lockdown because people could not go to hospitals. Even condom distribution, people did not have condoms, yet they were at home, they were in trading centers and so on. So there were those challenges during lockdown.
Absolutely. Now, there's a very interesting observation. When the Ministry of Health says there's a vaccination drive here, people's reluctance is really huge towards that. But when the Kabaka and his subjects and his people come up and say, okay, people, we need to go get vaccinated, or we have to, there's a health camp here, everybody goes running. How do you package the messaging of information to reach the core of internet subjects that is unique to the Kabaka? When you mention the Kabaka, everyone goes. When you mention the Ministry of Health, a few go.
Well, I think you said it all. You answered the question yourself.
Did.
Yeah, it's about the Kabaka. Because the Kabaka is our head, he's our king, and you know, the people of Buganda, his subjects love him. Baganda and non-Baganda, his subjects love him. They trust him, you know. He's usually at the forefront for making, you know, health programs, you know, social well-being, even economic welfare. So when he talks, people listen. And people actually, because during the recent vaccination drive, there are people who came all the way. I was talking to a lady who came from Nyenga. Nyenga is somewhere, you know, you branch off at Nile in Jinja. It's in Chagwe Deep. And she came for vaccination because the Kabaka said. So it is, and also, you know, the Kabaka has his structures. When he talks, it goes through the kingdom-owned media houses, but also through the chiefs and the clan leaders, under the office of the Katikiro. These messages are rallied. But the moment the people hear that it's the Kabaka who has said, go for HIV testing, go for vaccination, like the blood donation drive, the blood bank, the Uganda Blood Transfusion Services had failed to raise blood, you know, enough blood to be able to, you know, to satisfy the country's need. But you see what the blood donation drive is doing. Just 5 days in Chadondo here, we got over 18,000 units in just 5 days. And also all the other counties, you know, collected thousands of units. And it's because people had Kabaka Agambi, Mugende Mugabo Msai, Mugende Baba Geme. That's how, you know, it happens. It all runs around his popularity and this sense of belonging that people have. Yeah.
The attachment they have. Maybe it's also with the messaging. Maybe there's a way you twist and tweak your messages around.
The trick is to put in the Kabaka. Because you may write all the Luganda, you know, but if you actually, because people trust anything, be it mosquito nets, if anything is from the Kabaka, they'll do it. If you tell them Kabaka Agambi Mwambale masks, they'll do it.
Okay. Well, next time we're trying to do something, we'll definitely have to come to the Kabaka and find a way of having things done around here. All right. Now, the Kabaka still has rallied his subjects to fight COVID-19, but he has also rallied now for HIV, right? HIV/AIDS. And gender-based violence, yes. What does this mean to you people at the front line of disease prevention and health promotion in Buganda?
For us, it's an exciting moment. I mean, these are it's exciting for, you know, for, because HIV, to tell you the truth, the HIV prevalence in Buganda is higher than the national prevalence. Because whereas the national prevalence is now 5.3, Buganda or what is termed as central, 1 and 2, is over 8%, meaning that 8 out of 100 people have HIV, whereas the whole country is at 5, you know? So for him to come out, first of all, and accept the ambassadorial role, but then also to prioritize HIV messages, prevention, and then care for the people who are sick, I think it's an exciting time for us. It has made our work much easier, you know, because, I mean, now people come. You know, there's nothing as bad as putting a health camp and people don't come to do the HIV testing. But now people come for testing. People responded to the condoms, both female and male, you know, whereas before he put in his voice, people would say, oh, those condoms, oh, all sorts of things. But now, it makes things much easier for us. And of course, the best thing is also that the messages are going down through the systems, from the Saza chief to the Gombolola, to the Muluka chief, up to the Batongole, from the clan leaders, and we have clan leaders up to the household level. So the messages go down, and also the kingdom-owned media houses. So it's an exciting time to see that we can all come together, and we know that with this effort, the HIV prevalence in Buganda is going to come down, and Uganda as a whole.
Absolutely. Of course, once it's down in Buganda, it is all over.
Yeah, because we're the most popular, so absolutely. I know it will bring it down.
Okay. Now, as public health activists and stakeholders, how best can we rally our communities to the theme of World AIDS Day 2021, which is End Inequalities, End AIDS? There's a special focus on reaching people left behind. How our communities, we realize, play a huge role. Buganda itself is a community, a huge community, rallying, of course, the entire country. How best can we achieve this End Inequalities, End HIV/AIDS?
I think we need to, like, say, leave no one behind. We need to now think of all those groups, people living with disabilities. When you think about, you know, all the messages that come out, are there messages in Braille? What do the deaf do who can't listen to, you know, radio and so on? We need to make sure that we address these things. Because you go to health facilities, no one can speak, use sign language, you know? And maybe we need to look at those areas which we had left out to make sure that we reach out to all these, you know, previously left out communities. They are within our communities, and they also contribute to the HIV incidence and prevalence. Yeah, so in our messages, I think we need now to be more sensitive to all these people. Are we including everyone? I remember there's a time we had a workshop in Kalangala, and those fishermen said that this message doesn't speak to us, you know, the brochures we took to them, because for them, they only fear water. They don't fear small viruses which kill you in 20 years.
Are you serious?
Yes. So we need to know, who are we talking to? Does the message, the way we package it, can it speak to them? Or will they just overlook it? Because if you look at them, for them, every single minute of their life, they're in danger of, you know, dying in that lake. So if you just put a message that you put to a civil servant, it may not talk to them. So we have to package the messages to make sure that we speak to these different communities identified.
Right. I like that you mentioned the fishing communities, because they're majorly in central region. Packaging of their messages should be different. But as I highlighted earlier, the myth around that, they say that the more women they sleep with, the more fish they will catch. And how are we going to address this? How are we going to tap into the myth and make it real and remind them that, no, this is real? Because the women also carry HIV.
I think the most important thing is, first of all, to make sure that we interest them to involve, you know, to think about their lives as well, because it's their life, and to show them, you know, the good things that come in living your life to its fullest, seeing your children graduate, seeing your grandchildren, and so on and so forth, but also giving them the options, because like I said, we quickly understood that we could not talk about abstinence or being faithful to them. Actually, they said, for us, we can't be faithful because this is the issue. So then we talk about, please test for HIV, please use a condom. And when you use a condom, use it correctly and consistently. You know, don't put it in your shirt pocket because you know you're going to meet someone and the body temperature of your shirt pocket, your body temperature is actually going to affect that condom. And we need to teach these people. One border guy was saying that when he wants to go to, you know, and meet a lady, he puts on his condom early enough just in case he forgets. And that is, you know, that means every time he wants to go to the toilet, he puts it off and then on again. Yes, and we take it for granted that people know how to use condoms. So we need to actually intensify what we had thought and taken for granted, because research has shown that, you know, people, especially the youth, their knowledge on HIV is also not that good. It's below 50% of them, yeah. So we need to go back to the drawing board and package these messages befitting this generation, but make sure that we speak to each community as it comes.
Yeah, I like that you bring out the border issue, because I've encountered several people who have said, I am not going to use a condom because things are not going to be the way I want them. If I use a condom, I will miss out on the goodness that I'm looking for. And we still have such people. 40 years later, we still have people who still reason like that. And maybe either we are not doing enough as one, as the media, or as champions of HIV/AIDS. I don't know. Where are we lacking in the messaging, in educating people, in sensitizing people? 40 years later, it's still so embarrassing to hear a grown-up man telling you, I'm not going to use a condom. It's terrible.
Yes, it's terrible, but we still have to talk to responsibility in people's lives. And we have to know, for example, the commercial sex workers, they say that men pay you more if you don't use a condom. Now, what kind of thing is that? Because the men sleeping with them, and people, fathers, husbands, civil servants, business people sleeping with these girls, and they insist, I'll pay you 20,000 if you don't use a condom. If you use a condom, I'll pay you 5,000 only. So that means that we have to actually now go back and repackage. And I know that with coming of ARVs, people, you know, have become complacent. There's no one slimming anymore. People, everyone looks healthy. Because in the 90s, HIV was scary. And I remember there was this huge signpost around City Square where there was this beautiful girl in red in high heels with a very nice figure. But when you reach her head, it was a skeleton, you know, it was a skull, you know, and that was so scary. There used to be a drum, you know, after every so often on the radios about HIV. There used to be plays, that, you know, through drama, through music, talking about HIV. But now because ARVs, people know that they can live healthily, you know, people looking good, people now have become complacent. They don't fear HIV anymore, but it's still there. And in reality, still here in our community. And we now have children who are born with HIV. They have now matured, you know, and they're now interacting with the HIV negative kids. So we really need to go back to the drawing board and repackage messages, addressing the responsibility of everyone, each and every one of us, to protect one another.
Absolutely. And stop being very, very uninformed. It is terrible for you not to be informed, you know. Now, Dr. Fiona, the World Health Organization is and its partners are highlighting the growing inequalities in access to essential health HIV/AIDS services. Particularly, I want us to talk about the vulnerable communities, the at-risk communities. We have sex workers, we have, I know we shy away from this, but the truth is we have the LGBTI communities within us in Uganda. We need to face the reality and the challenges this face. Rather, this brings to us as a country and, of course, as a kingdom. How best can we address inequalities, especially targeting these vulnerable communities, women and children, the LGBTI communities, the sex workers, and of course, we talked about the fishermen as well. Inequalities in accessing HIV/AIDS services.
That is, you know, that question, I think, goes back also to government. Because when these people feel like they are being victimized, yes, and they go underground, it is a problem. But we also know that there's, you know, there are some clinics in this country where they can go and, you know, and get access to care, access to testing without feeling victimized. So I think that's a step in the right direction. Now, with women and children, I think that's where we have to put the emphasis as well and make sure that the girl child, you know, is empowered, that women are empowered, that husbands are on board to allow them to go get these services, you know. And then there's an important group that we usually miss, but I think it became very relevant during COVID, the truck drivers.
Yes.
These actually transport the, you know, viruses because all over the place, because they have homes in whichever, you know, towns they camp in. So we need to have social support for these people, support groups targeting these through their leaders, through the border coordinators, bring them on board, and then we have services, we have condoms distributed. The sex workers have a particular condom, you know, they like, you know, the one they call gold, it's labeled gold, you know, and maybe the men who feel that these other condoms are not so good should try those condoms, because there's a reason why the sex workers want them. But the sex workers should also be, you know, because we know they are there, we cannot shy away from the fact that they're there. And most of the HIV infections happen in them, but not only in them, because when they say that they have the new HIV infections happen in sex workers sleep with people's husbands, people's sons, people's brothers, people's bosses and colleagues and so on. So we also have to think about the partners. So that means that there's a sexual network, because those men also have wives, you know. So we have to really target these people and make sure, and there are NGOs now who target them to make sure that we have the right messages for them, and that they don't feel that they are victimized when they go for these services and left out, because they're there. We cannot hide. You just have to drive around Kampala at night and you know that they're
and you
there.
Know that even during lockdown you'd see them anyway. So it's funny you mentioned they have a specific condom they prefer. I think I need to do research on that one. Now let's talk about people living with HIV/AIDS, because those have brought to the front the misconceptions, the myths that surround HIV, and of course it makes it more confusing and very difficult to live with it. In Buganda Kingdom, in Central Region, we know people have come forward to say they're HIV positive, and we have rallied support around them. We have cheered them on, tried to push them to, you know, make more noise about this virus, I beg your pardon. How challenging is it for communities to adapt to people living with HIV/AIDS? Because 40 years later, honestly, we should come around. COVID has come and all of a sudden we are okay with it. I wanted to use kawa. We are okay with it. We seem to, you know, come about simply with it. But HIV is still such a is still such a monster in the house.
Thank you, Lynn. The people who are infected with HIV are one of the major groups that must be targeted for HIV prevention messages. Because it's only someone who has HIV who can spread it. Someone who is HIV negative cannot spread it. So these people must be targeted with messages, not only to look after themselves, but to make sure that they, you know, prevent transmission to others. We encourage people living with HIV to eat, you know, eat properly, balanced diets, avoid alcohol and drugs, and also take their drugs religiously, you know. We in Buganda, we now have a group called Abagabe Bakabaka. These are Mukurani Samkenenye. These are youth who were born with HIV. They've been taking ARVs since they were babies, since from the syrups to now tablets. They are lawyers, they are engineers, they are at campus, they are doing their degrees, some are in secondary schools. We feel that this is a powerful tool that can speak to the youth, because many young people think HIV is for the older people. You know, not knowing that this girlfriend you have in senior three may have been born with HIV or gotten it any other way. So we have to use these people, you know, as a powerful tool of prevention, and also so that they take their drugs, viral load becomes undetectable, and they continue with their lives. But they also protect others by using condoms. So, but also we have to talk to the communities about stigma and discrimination. Many people, children in schools taking ARVs, being discriminated by the school nurses, by teachers. You know, we have a tale, one student who told us that when she went to the sick bay of her school, she's on ARVs in school and the nurse knows. So the nurse was saying, all of you line up here, that one will take last, you know, was giving them cough linkers because she has HIV. That means that the nurse is not informed, you know, about, you know, confidentiality, but also about how HIV is transmitted. So, and these children end up not taking their drugs very well and then increasing chances of transmitting to partners when they get them. So stigma and discrimination, 40 years later, is still a challenge. There's still some jobs where, you know, people are asked about their HIV status, you know? So, and when they are phone positive, some people don't get those jobs.
Yes.
Yeah. And some people still get, feel that they are not free to talk about their, people point fingers at them. So stigma and discrimination is something that needs to be addressed as well.
Absolutely. Especially with people living with HIV AIDS. It's a very, very difficult time for them with all that in communities. The other day I was speaking to the UNAIDS director, Uganda, and it might sound as a joke, but it's a big concern. People are saying the world raced quickly to get a COVID-19 vaccine, but the HIV/AIDS vaccine, I mean, years later, we still don't have anything. And people say, but why? Why can't we have this? And the director was quick to say, it is a science issue. I cannot really, you know, explain further about that. It's a science issue. What do you think? Is it a disease that was, you know, thrown onto us as a punishment from God? Why have we not found a solution to it?
That question, you know, is asked very often these days, and I'll also echo what the director said, it's a science issue. The HIV/AIDS vaccine, you know, development initiative has taken decades. HIV has different strains, HIV mutates. And actually, I want to remind people that if you have HIV and you think you can sleep around because you are on your ARVs, you may get reinfected with another strain, you know? So it has been difficult to develop. It has gone through the stages, you know, and there are different stages from the lab to the mice, to the monkeys, until you get a vaccine. And this vaccine development is still, you know, in process. Actually, some of the trials happened here in Uganda at JCRC, at the International AIDS Vaccine Initiative, and we've not been able to get a vaccine yet. Mainly because of, you know, the mutating and the different strains. Now, COVID is also a virus. COVID also has mutants. I think now you've heard of the new one, But I want to say this about COVID, because people are asking, how come COVID now we don't see as many cases as there were before?
Doctor, people are refusing to take vaccines because they're saying that it takes forever, it takes a long time to come up with a vaccine that actually works. But then with COVID, there was a quick response. We had vaccines within at least 8 months. And they're saying, no, but I suspect this vaccine.
No, the reason is science, like she said, and I'm also saying. But this vaccine the vaccines we're using have gone through some of the you know, the emergency. Actually, they were fast tracked, because if you remember how this pandemic, millions of people were dying, you know. But I want to also say, because people always ask, COVID is why has COVID been reduced and now the lockdowns are being, you know, and HIV, we are still talking about HIV. It was easier during the lockdown to control COVID, people washing hands, people masking. It's easier to control COVID than to control HIV. In one way, that even if the president stood today in putting on his uniform and commanded, I don't want any of you to have sex, unprotected sex. No one, I mean, he doesn't look into people's bedrooms. It's difficult to effect the HIV prevention. It's a personal responsibility, something that we have to do as people. Whereas you can say that we've locked you down, everyone stay in your homes. If you don't have a mask, you won't enter this mall, etc. So there are some differences between COVID and HIV, but HIV has these strains, different strains, and also mutates.
Absolutely. So, well, we need to be patient and maybe hope for something. As we wind up, we are heading into we are looking at the World AIDS Day and inequalities and HIV, but we're also looking at a major role Mengo is playing in the fight against HIV/AIDS. In your conclusive remarks, Dr. Fiona.
I just want to appeal to Uganda, and to Uganda in particular, because that's where the highest HIV prevalence is. Let it be a responsibility of all of us. All of us. Everyone in your individual capacity to prevent the spread of HIV, but also to take care and not discriminate against those who have HIV. And then also my appeal to the government, because we know that there are laws that are making some of these vulnerable populations feel discriminated against, and they are going underground, and that is very dangerous. We need to think about this and try to see how we can accommodate these people, because in actual fact, they are there. So I want to thank the Kabaka of Buganda for wisely giving us the theme for men to take leadership in fighting HIV and protecting the girl child. Savasajja Kabaka.
Hey, wonderful, wonderful. I also call upon you, because the World Health Organization is rallying global leaders and citizens against inequalities that drive HIV/AIDS to reach people who are currently not receiving essential services. So I'm urging you, please go out there, get tested, and please get information. Stop behaving like I don't know, like we're back in 80s. No. Let's be informed and know that HIV is still here with us, and we can prevent it. And people living with HIV/AIDS are not walking dead. No, they are living. So you have to rally yourselves. You have to be supportive. And let's end inequalities come 2030. I thank you very much, Dr. Fiona, for joining us for Checkpoint. I have been Lynn. We'll catch you another time. God bless you.